Epiglottitis is a potentially life-threatening condition that occurs when the epiglottis gets swollen. Now, to really understand epiglottitis, you have to understand what the epiglottis is. So right over here, what I'm circling, this is the epiglottis. It's really just a little small lid that is protective of the airway. And I've got a couple different views right here so you can really see. You know, I'm not the best artist, so hopefully this rendition you can kind of understand what's going on here. But this is just a cross-section down the middle of the patient to really expose what the airway looks on the inside. So this would be the throat, right? This is the trachea down here. This would be the larynx, also known as the glottis. Also, you may be more familiar with vocal cords, that term. So these would be the vocal cords, and over the vocal cords is the epiglottis. And like I said, that just protects the airway. So when you eat food or swallow a substance, so for example, let's do a glass of water. Let's say water's going in into the mouth. And so right here, I didn't highlight this before, but this is the tongue. Over here's the roof of the mouth, and here's your uvula. So that's just the little dangly thing in the back of the throat that you see hanging down. So when water's coming through, right, you don't want water to get into the airway. Otherwise, you'll start coughing and, you know, you could potentially have an infection and damage to lung tissue if bacteria goes in with that water. So to be able to protect the airway, the epiglottis, whenever you swallow, this little flap goes down. So it'll kind of cover it up like that, kind of flip over. And so that protects the airway, protects the lungs from water or food or anything from getting into it. So you swallow and water will go down the right hole, down the esophagus. So that's really the concept of what the epiglottis does. It protects the airway. And so there's also this other sketch over here from a different angle that I want to show you. Here again is the epiglottis. Here are the vocal cords right here. And you've got the, so here's the epiglottis. Let's go ahead and circle that. And you've also got something called the ari epiglottic folds. And so these ari epiglottic folds are these little flaps on the side that connect the epiglottis down to this area over here. And the reason it's named the ari epiglottic folds is because it goes down to where the arytenoid cartilage is. And so these, what I'm circling right here is the arytenoid cartilage. Now I point this out because the arytenoid cartilage actually controls the vocal cords. So they actually control the closure of the vocal cords themselves to add extra protection for the airway. And here I have another sketch that I drew showing an overhead view. So this view right here is looking down at the vocal cords from this angle. And so you see up here is the epiglottis, right, corresponds to over here. And down the side right here is the ari epiglottic folds. And you can see I kind of drew them a little bit in my picture too, just going down. So I'm repeating all of this just so you can get a clear understanding of what the normal view of the epiglottis and the airway looks like. Because the issue with epiglottitis is this epiglottis can swell so much that it expands to block the airway. So whereas before it was just this tiny little flap, now it's swollen to enormous size and it's actually closing off the ability for air to pass through into the trachea or into the windpipe. Now you can imagine because of this is very severe. In fact, George Washington most likely actually died from complications of epiglottitis back in 1799. Really interesting, kind of a little side note. Of course, they didn't really have any cures for epiglottitis back then. Antibiotics weren't invented until the 20th century. But interestingly enough, one physician suggested that they could establish an airway by cutting into the skin through the cartilage, between the thyroid cartilage and the cricoid cartilage, to cut a hole into the airway to allow breathing. And of course, this is actually accepted nowadays as a treatment known as a cricothyroidotomy, right? Cricoid cartilage and thyroid cartilage. But this physician was actually scoffed at, and they didn't perform this life-saving procedure on the first president of the United States. So epiglottitis obviously can be very serious. And it's especially serious in children because they have a smaller airway. The diameter of their airway is already fairly narrow, so any additional swelling can cause this closure to be more prominent and more serious. So swelling of the epiglottis can actually give some very distinct symptoms. Obviously, the patient will be experiencing a sore throat. They might also have a fever. A patient might also have a muffled voice because, you know, they have difficulty speaking because it's so sore. This epiglottis is so sore. So they might have a what's called a hot potato voice, where they're leaning their throat forward and trying to talk without causing too much vibration to this area. That's called a hot potato voice, where it sounds very muffled. Patients do this to avoid causing pain to their throat. Now, as before I said, patients may have difficulty swallowing, so that can actually lead to drooling. So you see, pediatric patients will be drooling because, you know, they don't want to swallow, so all the saliva just builds up. Another interesting symptom that can be seen is called stridor. And what stridor is described as is kind of a musical sound on inspiration. So when a patient breathes in oxygen, which I'll do this light blue color, it is trying to get into the airway. And because the airway is narrowed, air kind of has this musical tune as it goes through. This is similar to trying to whistle. When you purse your lips, you narrow that airway and allow the wind to create a sound. So it actually sounds like on inspiration, a patient has inspiratory stridor. It kind of sounds like a, kind of, they're trying to breathe. And it's because this airway is narrowed and they can't get air into the lungs. Now, of course, this is an emergency and patients with epiglottitis should be brought to the emergency department right away. There should be really no delay because the swelling can get worse and worse and eventually close up the airway, leading to pulmonary arrest. So difficulty swallowing along with drooling, maybe the stridor, you might start thinking of epiglottitis. And all of this can develop within a couple hours of a fever starting, so it can be very serious. And it should not be taken lightly.